Hey, this is Daron from System of a Down, and you're logged on to guitar.com. So. I just always wanted to play the drums, and so my parents said that they wouldn't buy me the drums because you can't turn them off. So I bought, they got me a guitar, and I started playing the guitar, and I started getting better at it. So I said, okay, I'll stick to this. And then I started realizing I could write songs. And then that became like something that, you know, just made me stick to the guitar. And I still love the drums though. I mean, the drums are my favorite instrument. I play very light drums, like, you know, it's like if I was playing for the Stones or something, I can keep a 4/4 beat, but like, I don't do any Neil Peart type of stuff. I mean, you know, so I'm not a drummer. I have like a drummer's mind, you can say, but I'm not physically a drummer.
But you have, at times, you play very percussively.
Yeah, I'm a better rhythm player than I am a solo player by far, I think. Yeah, like Maiden records and anything metal back in those days except for Manowar. I don't know, Aussie stuff, Randy Rhoads. Just a whole bunch of different guitar players, too many to even mention. And it's not just the guitar that influences me to go places, it's like different, you know, sometimes there's so many lead singers that, like Iggy Pop, you know, is a big inspiration for me when it comes to just attitude and playing and doing it all with attitude. And just different people, there's too many to name, you know. But,
who was your first big guitar hero, though?
Well, my first big band ever was Kiss, so I guess I'd have to say Ace Frehley, you know, because he was in Kiss. But then again, that's like saying, you know, back in those days, I'd say Peter Criss, the greatest drummer on earth. No offense to Peter Criss, but hey, you know, John Bonham will whip his ass, you know? So, I don't know, I guess Ace Frehley was the first guitar player ever that I ever, like, you know, knew. But Guitar Hero, I don't know, like, Randy Rhoads, Eddie Van Halen, a lot of 80s guys, because I basically grew up in the 80s, you know, as an 80s kid, and metal was really big back then, so. I remember I used to play Iron Man like this, really bad. And then someone said, that's not how you hold the power chord. So it's like, someone just taught me how to, like, someone told me, hey, put your finger down there, and you'll get a better power chord than going. Still not playing it right, that's just the key that I chose right now, it was in B. Iron Man in B. That's just off, you know, sitting in your room for like 7 to 10 hours a day and playing. And every day, and I was like, I don't know, still sometimes. So if I can get the chance, I do. I remember when I was like a teenager, I used to get home and play for hours, like 7 or 8, 10 hours a day, and like I'd realize, damn, time just flew by, and like I'd be like, damn, I gotta eat something, you know, you know. Or, masturbation is great for the right arm. around is do stuff like, you know, I don't know, nothing in particular, just I feel like playing the guitar, so let's play the guitar, you know? Like, doodle around, I don't know, just screw around. It's really hard to say what I used to do exactly. Play Sabbath riffs or something, or try to figure out how to play South of Heaven, you know. Like, just by listening to it on the stereo or something, I'd hear, whoa, there's a new Slayer record, and then, like, try to play it. I go through, like, no. I just go through the riff of the first song we're gonna play, or, like, I just make sure I'm warmed up to play the first song if I'm going to start the first song, you know, or whatever the first song is, you know, usually Sleepy or No or Plug or something. Yes, also anything like Elvis Crespo, the guy who sings Suave Mente, that guy's cool. I like, you know, a lot of different, I like the Apex Twin. He's a really cool electronic guy, and I don't know, there's a lot of cool DJs like Frankie Bones and DJ Shadow. He's really cool. Carl Cox, I've been listening to some of his CDs lately. So yeah, I do like some dance music DJ stuff, because it's all like very drum orientated, so I'm really into the rhythm and vocals when it comes down to music. The guitar is pretty much the last thing I think about, and I'm the guitar player of the band, but I, as a composer or someone who writes music or whatever, that when I'm in the frame of mind of doing that, I'm really not thinking of my part too much as I'm thinking about what else would be going on while I'm doing my part, you know what I mean? And then I'll think of, then I'll do it, you know what I mean? I'll do my thing last, you know? So, basically, you know, I do a lot of writing for the band, so I write some music here, and I'll take it to the band and, you know, create a vibe. I try to create the vibe with, you know, just, I'm a drummer in my head, so it's like when I'm playing these riffs sometimes, I have all these beats that are going into my head, you know, it's like I might be playing a Tony Iommi riff, but like have like a breakbeat in the background, and I'd be going to John and say, hey, try that, that'd be funny, you know what I mean, it'd be fun, like if you listen to our song on the tribute record, I mean, it's sort of like James Brown meets salsa version of Snowblind. And that's just like sort of what we like to do, you know, and expand it a little bit, like still keep it heavy, keep it serious, yet have a light side to it. I don't know, it's hard to explain. It's some people try to have us explain, you know, what, why does it work? You know, you have like a singer, he talks about some serious issues, and then I'm a guitar player and I do some quacky stuff sometimes, and like I say, I'm the dude that says sugar or whatever, and like, how does that work? And we're like, I don't know, you guys are the ones that bought the records, we don't know how it works. We were just doing it, like trying to expand, you know, ourselves to what we want to do, you know. Well, I play solos, but my solos would tend to be something closer to like, not like what, You know, I just mentioned maybe Randy Rhoads and Eddie Van Halen, but I probably wouldn't play like them. I'd probably play closer to like someone like a Mark Knopfler or a Jerry Garcia or a Jimmy Page mixed, you know, Carlos Santana, David Gilmour. When it comes to my soloing, I keep it simple. I don't like the whole, you know, it's not that I don't like it. I like listening to like stuff like Yngwie Malmsteen. I love Buckethead. I think he's great. It's just not the path that I mean, I used to have friends that played like that, and I never really, it's not the path that I take in my playing. I just never was interested in going doing that. I'm more into songwriters and people who write songs and how you, there's a certain attitude you can bring out of the guitar that, like, you don't really need to be playing 100 notes at a time. And Carlos Santana can probably tell you the same thing, you know, like, he can take a note and take it forever, and it'll make you feel something. And when I play more melodically, and, you know, I like to have melodic type of solos if I have a solo. Like, not very many heavy guitar players have been soloing these days, and, like, on our record, you'll hear, like, I don't know, 3 or 4 songs, maybe, that have guitar solos in them. Just because as a songwriter, I said, hey, you know, it fits. It's not like, you know, the 80s, like, where every song had to have one. But, like, it doesn't mean, like, now that we're in a different era that you can't have one. You know what I mean? I think you can have guitar solos every now and then. It just don't overdo it, you know, tastefully. I love playing Icemans. I really love them. This is a baritone they just made for me. It's an Iceman 2. So they're going to start making these. They're quite different. So you can see that used to be the old Iceman. Here's a little bit. So they haven't really made any of these in the market yet. So I'm pretty much the first dude that has it. So I'm cool.
Does it sound any different than this one?
Yeah, because it's a baritone.
Oh.
This is a... just a regular standard type of guitar. This one is in between a guitar and a bass, so this pretty much has like a lot more of like a bassier type of sound. You get more chunky, like, and still have that quicker attack that I can have, and have like a really low bass bump because it's in between, you know, like, and it's a 60 on top and it's a 12 on bottom with the strings, so the strings are a lot thicker than that. I think it's a 56 on that and 10s on the bottom. You know, that's going to give you a lot more attack. This one's going to give you a lot more chunk, you know, if you want to come off sounding like Caius, you know what I mean? Like, if you wanted to come out with that bulk, then I would use this guitar. If you wanted to come out with, you know, say, more attacky type of, you know, Daryl type of stuff, I don't know, I would use something more like that, because the strings are thinner and it's just more attacky, and you can play quicker on that. So on the next record, I just want to combine both. On stage, I've been using this lately because it just gives me a bit of both, you know?
Could you play something on this one so we can hear?
It's probably going to sound the same. Well. These are differences you can tell only on record. This is one I still play on stage a lot. I mean, we did Conan with this one. I can tell as a player, it's just more attacky. Like, you'd be able to do something like something like that easier on this guitar, like, make it scream. On that guitar, it would be a lot harder to make it scream. Like. I don't want seven strings, and that's just, you know, it's like, I like the bass, I like to play bass, I've written some songs on the bass, and that can give me a vibe of having like a bassy type of vibe, yet still being a guitar. I can hold the same guitar chords, you know, seven strings, I've never played one before, but I don't see myself wanting to play one. I don't know, it's not my thing. That was one way of getting a thicker sound and a lower tone without detuning, like we've dropped it already, that we're dropped down a C, so it's like without going any lower. That was one way of like getting a guitar to be sounding more bulkier and more bigger without changing my, you know, scales or anything, you know, just staying sixth string, and it's not exactly normal, it's a baritone, but it's just, I don't know, that's the only way that I thought that I can do that, you know, is get a bigger sound without changing my whole rig around or whatever, you know.
Well, you just answered my next question, which was about tunings. If you use any other odd tunings.
Well, the guitars are dropped one step from this, like, it's just regular. Up until here. And then this last string is, like, you can hold a power chord with one finger. So, it's dropped. The whole guitar sort of like dropped down one step, and then the string is dropped down too, so we can have it. And it makes like quicker on the, like on the riff. You can do things that you can do with one finger, like up here with riffs or over here, because you're still playing the riff with one finger, you know what I mean? Like you can go. Like it would be a lot more difficult if you were trying to do that. With your fingers, like this way you just go. Throw a beat over it. And everyone kick each other's ass.
Remain in this space for dart scratch. I'm a desires.